Good morning, everybody. I think it's nice to see people sitting, at least a few people sitting over here. So I'll just introduce the course first. So my topic is decision making in RD surgery and introduction to the course. A small video. A little bit of audio also. Choosing a step in RD surgery may not be as difficult as choosing a dish from a menu. But one thing is for sure, you have to decide carefully and never take a decision based on a financial basis. Because you may have to repent even a single wrong decision. And you will try hard to hide your mistakes. You'll make all kinds of excuses. Even if you do all these things, the mistakes will come to you again and again. You may have to eat the bitter pie again and again. And you may try to put the blame on something else. But the mistakes will come back to you. So you have to, the first decision is to be a right decision, and you have to decide quite rightfully. So a few decision problems that we face during managing retinal detachment is first and foremost is the vitrectomy or buccal or pneumoretinopexy, what to do. And this debate will keep on going on. And in green, I have marked the indications where you need, where there's no problem in decision. In complicated RDs, you have to go with vitrectomy. In young patients or in pediatric patients, everybody's first choice will be buckling. And pneumoretinopexy, you may do it in failed buccal procedures and or breaks in upper half of the retina. I am more of a vitrectomy fan with buckling. I'll advise buckling in pediatric patients or adults with a clear lens and inferior breaks. And pneumoretinopexy reserved for breaks in 10 to 2 zone and clear lens and for fish mouthing after buccal surgery. And there are problems also with attached with both of all these three procedures. With the vitrectomy, there's an increased incidence of cataract, there is increased cost, and post-op positioning is required. With buckling, you have a lot of conjunctival scarring and globe distortion and ocular motility disturbances. And with pneumoretinopexy, you have very strict post-op positioning, a very low single surgery success rate, and you need to do a very immaculate pre-op retinal examination. Another controversy that exists is silicone oil versus gas. And for silicone oil, it gives you an effective long-term tamponade, and post-op exam is easier. Patients, if they want to fly, can fly immediately after the surgery. But the problem is that it needs to be removed, and a second surgery is required. The day you do a silicone oil, the second surgery you have to do. And proper sealing of breaks is not there, as the tamponade is not as good as the gas, which leads to migration of cells and more chances of PVR. With gas, it gives you a fairly effective long-term tamponade. Post-op exam needs practice, and the patient is unable to fly for at least 2 to 3 weeks after you have done gas, after you put gas in the eye. The gas absorbs on its own and you don't need a second surgery. And the proper sealing of breaks it provides, and thus minimizing the risk of PBR. But if you feel that you are not able to relieve the traction completely, go for silicone oil. If you're sure you have taken care of all the traction, go for gas. Most of the complicated surgeries that we're going to discuss now will need oil. And in children and young adults, gas is preferable because oil, putting an oil in a child, I think it's not a very good indication. Another is whether you have to do a complete base excision for a simple RD or you just go in for a core vitrectomy or a central vitrectomy. And there are plus and minus points for both of them. Base excision, there's incidence of missing anterior breaks is very less if you do a proper break incision. And it also minimizes incidence of post-op PVR, and it is must for anterior PVR cases. For core vitrectomy only, that incidence of iatrogenic breaks, if you do, this is more for base excision. And some people say, like, you have to do only a central vitrectomy, go up to the base, and then complete the surgery other, and do the other steps. PVR is induced mostly by migration of subretinal cells, but the, in favor of gas, some people have put forward that PVR is induced mostly by migration of subretinal cells into preretinal space, and gas, and not the vitreous that is left behind in the vitreous space. Vitreous is known to help closure of breaks in buccals. These are all points in favor of central vitrectomy. And leaving vitreous behind does not lead to PVR in most of the cases of buccals or pneumoretinopexy on its own. Most of the cases won't need a complete excision of vitreous base, essential if anterior PVR is present. So limited or 360 degree retinopexy, again, there's plus and minus points for both, but go for 360 degree retinopexy if even a slight suspicion of a missed break is there or formation of new break seems likely. In most of primary RDs, a limited retinopexy is sufficient. For triamcinolone, in most cases, RD PVD is present, so use triamcinolone when you suspect absence of PVD. So this is one video just to highlight when do you suspect PVD. If the RD is increasing, even when you are cutting away from the retina, it means that there is no PVD. So you, that is a strong suspicion of PVD. You identify it, putting with the IVTA, and then do a complete removal of the vitreous. We have a little extra time for this course, so I'll just take a few more minutes because Dr. Kamal Kishore is unable to come. He has already taken a flight back because his flight got preponed. Another is ILM peeling or no peeling. Presence of macular hole is an indication for ILM peeling with or without an inverted flap, you can do it. So this is another video because we are not going to, you see, I'm putting some, how to put a flap into the hole. In patient with retinal detachment. You can either stuff the hole or you can just layer it over the hole, which way you feel comfortable in these patients at least. And encircling band and no encircling band, Dr. Kamal Kishore would have discussed in detail about this, so I'm not, now because he is not here. So 360 degree support of vitreous is provided by the encircling band and it reduces circumferential traction. Is must if you are not very experienced in doing vitrectomies. You should go in for an encircling band. And the points in not in favor of encircling band are that it increases the surgical time, it leads to post-op conjunctival scarring, distortion of globe leads to ineffective tamponade, and it induces refractive errors and ocular motility disturbances. In the end, I just show small video and introduce my other fellow colleagues who will be discussing later on. I invite them all to join me on the dais. Yeah. Thank you. with this, I finish my talk and I invite Dr. Shobhit Chawla to start on his talk on colobomas and retinal detachment.
Yeah, yeah, please go ahead. Yeah. Well, I personally against it. Let me put it that way. I personally against this because what I have very clear understanding when you look at the common sense thinking, laser causes contraction of the retina.
Yes.
And you do 360-degree laser, it is added contraction. So you are worsening the traction. And there are cases where you have retina zip open along that edge subsequently. So do 360-degree laser only if you have multiple holes as or lesions all around, which isolated, which is difficult to treat. But if you're adding that, I would add definitely encircling band. Otherwise, you are inviting trouble. So I'm in favor of treating only wherever lesions are there. I'm dead against 360. And the concept of creating new aura, it doesn't hold good. It doesn't hold good at all. There is nothing like creating new aura. Everything gets just you have, even you are doing laser, you see, when you do laser, you see the in front of your eyes, the retina is contracting. And if you are doing so much of laser, you are inviting trouble.
Yeah, most of the cases you can manage without the 360-degree laser. It's, I think it's only for very complicated cases or where you can't find an initial break where from where the RD would have taken place or something like that. Yeah.
Pramod, yes. And...
Yeah, 3-6, because you have to do a laser somewhere, no? But you don't know where the break is actually.
When you don't know where it is, you don't have to, but then definitely I would support that with Bakal also.
Pramod and Sangeet, don't you think this is a very interesting question for a VRSI survey? Because so many surgeons I talk to are doing 360. I also feel very strongly about it. From the days of cryo, when we have seen contraction and issues because of cryo. So I think it's a very interesting question to be put. Nobody believes in it, but Lord do it.
Because the most important thing I don't believe in when you're operating, I want you to be meticulous, not saving
yes,
the time.
Exactly.
Not saving the scarring. You need to do a neat job. There is no place for cutting corner.
And
when your surgery comes to surgery.
And there is no shortcut to vitreous removal.
Absolutely, yeah.
No
shortcut, definitely.
So, managing RD with coloboma of choroid, I'll be making a presentation plus putting forward a few questions about things which I have not understood about doing surgery because I find surgery in RD with coloboma highly unpredictable in its long-term behavior. So, if we look at it, the data says 0.5 to 2.2 cases per 10,000 live births are there in coloboma. And the tears are explained not because the sensory retina is very thin and abnormal, underdeveloped, undifferentiated, diaphanous, flimsy, anomalous, and the sclera may be thin. Also, the course of the blood vessels across the coloboma. If you look carefully, in many cases, you find blood vessels bordering the defect, which is in the RD in coloboma. So, the prevalence of retinal detachment is quite high in various studies. It has been reported from 8.1 to 42%. And it's one of the common surgeries which come our way today, and many of these patients are only eyed, and many come with a cataract and lost one eye, and the second eye has a mild cataract with, it's a very common scenario. If RD is secondary to retinal breaks outside the colobomatous area, whether it is a giant retinal tear or it's a hole, it is treated GRT, then a vitrectomy, otherwise by scleral bucking surgery, but like a regular rheumatogenous RD as you would do in various kinds of. In my experience over the last 30 years, I've had to buckle only 6 cases of coloboma RD. Rest have, because the break was clear cut, there was no intercalary fluid, and rest of the cases have all gone vitrectomy. So the scale tends to shift towards more towards coloboma being involved in the RD. If the break is within the colobomatous area, then vitrectomy is required with silicone oil tamponade. So pars plana is the mainstay of management in such cases. Some groups have attempted scleral bucking, but with limited. Most commonly, breaks are seen in the intercalary membrane along the margin of the retinal detachment inside the coloboma, and solitary oval break in the center is also commonly seen. These are the configurations we see. One patient, both eyes 6x6 vision, but there was a break here. I would just do a laser here and wait and watch. There's no need, of course, for surgery here. PVD induction is done from the optic disc region by suction, and forceps peeling is required in young patients. It is a challenging issue to do PVD induction in these cases at times, and it really puts the surgeon at test. I have personally used, after creating a potential space, even liquid perfluorocarbon in a few cases where I inject it in the potential space, and it aids me in separating the vitreous further, and then a peel. So these cases, and you have to be careful, you don't want to create iatrogenic tears, and during surgery, of course, careful inspection of the colobomatous area should be done under high magnet during fluid air exchange. Fluid should be first attempted from the colobomatous area if that is involved. It acts as a guide to break localization in case of unidentifiable break. If there is visible fluid communication in between coloboma and RD, then the break is mostly inside the coloboma. If fluid stops before the colobomatous area, then there is a peripheral break outside the coloboma. And endolaser is done to peripheral breaks along with, I like to do 360 in these cases at least, so it's kind of a arc around and some peripheral laser. And fovea should be spared if it comes in the margin, which we have to be very conscious about. Silicone oil tamponade is the method of choice. Let me show a couple of surgeries first. This is a patient in which why isn't it coming? It's working beautifully. So in this case, we are doing a vitrectomy, and we go to the colobomatous area after a good vitrectomy and good vitreous removal. There is some vitreous still adherent at the periphery, which I'll remove under air, which I do at times, and it's drained well through with the colobomatous. It took time, but it's drained well through the colobomatous area. We use active suction in these cases. then of course AKB called this one, and then I'll go back to the presentation. This is one of Manish's cases, which I asked him to send to me, which I had seen earlier. This is a good representative case. It's a giant retinal tear with a coloboma coexisting. So this has to be treated like a GRT and not like coloboma RD, though the break is outside. It's a regular giant retinal tear, and one has to treat it like a giant retinal tear. So we do a complete surgery, just like a GRT surgery, and I'd like to go back to the presentation now. So patient, coloboma with RD, 10-year-old, only-eyed patient. Patient had nystagmus also. You see some chorioretinal atrophy here also. So we did a vitrectomy, membrane peeling, oil. He has ambulatory vision in this eye. Another patient I would like to present of optic disc coloboma, not actually a pit. Coloboma with PCIOL. This is a patient of optic nerve head coloboma and had a contiguous RD, very much like to what we would see in a case of a pit. So we treated it in a similar manner. We did vitrectomy, managed to remove the posterior hyoid well, and I took a foveal sparing flap and put it on top of the hole. That's the only thing I could think of. And then we extended the peel a little bit. And we got somewhat an okay result. This is a post-operative, that thing, it has gone down from before. And I would like to ask one question from the other colleagues here, that there are cases with clear break on the coloboma and you try to drain using a air pressure of about 30, and you're using active suction. You are not able to many times drain from the colobomatous break, and you have to create a retinotomy. What is the reason? Is the reason that the air pressure leads to abutting of the mobile retina against the coloboma edge and entrapment of the fluid? What do you feel is the cause? I have seen it in quite a few cases, and this is something which has quizzed me.
See, quite some time, like things. One, you have a peripheral break. The second thing, you have break in a coloboma area.
No, I'm talking of a break in a coloboma.
Yeah.
Periphery is clear.
No, let me come to that. And the third thing, you have break in a intracalary membrane, but not intracalary membrane, that is coloboma, and your coloboma edge. Now, almost all the time, you have retina in coloboma area invariably detached.
Yes,
and you can still have a break there.
Yeah.
Now, unless you have a continuation through in that coloboma edge, somewhere break somewhere other around, then only a superior retina will detach. We have to have communication if fluid has to go through. There is a possibility you can have a separate breakup in a retina somewhere, tiny break. You still have break in a colobomatous area, but there may not be communication through. So if you see retina which is detached and in continuation with a detached retina in a coloboma, then probably you know there is communication. If that scenario, if you drain through that break, yes, it will leak, it will come out. but you have this isolated detachment, that area is detached, but you at the edge of the coloboma, it is firmly attached. It is not continuously detached. You will not be able to drain because there is no communication. And then you need a retinotomy because it's like any other regmatogenarity where somewhere tiny break, we can't make out where it is.
Yeah, maybe that is one of the factors. But there have been cases where I've seen fluid across the coloboma edge and I've not been able to drain fully. I have had residual fluid despite active suction. I don't use too much high pressure. My max is 30, 25 to 30. And then I have to go back. I do a peripheral retinotomy, and I put in the snake and then make it dry. That's the procedure I've been following. Do you approve of that procedure?
If you cannot drain, then yes. But most of the time, what happens when you that irrespective of pressure, when you're filling with the air, air is, because of surface tension, going to squeeze the fluid posteriorly. And if some communication is there, it should come out. The only issue is probably there is no communication there between two of them. Though you have this colobomatous area because of various reasons, anatomical, pathological reason, patho-anatomy, what we know is, probably it is game, but then there's still whole thing is holding it attached, holding it on.
Yeah.
I mean, there is, you want to say something?
Great.
There is beautiful work by Dr. Lingamopal, Dr. Mohd must be saying that.
Yeah.
He says that if you start draining, you know, the moment you start the fluid gas exchange, if it starts coming, you know, probably it's the intercalary fluid is draining.
If it stops short, that's...
If it stops short, either there's a peripheral break or there's a break in the LCM.
That's exactly
the LCM. So the LCM break is there, not draining, that is the point to make retinotomy.
That's exactly what I'm trying to tell you. That's what I mean.
In fact, all our coloboma surgery is guided by the papers by Dr. Gopal only, actually.
I had a question for sir. For eyes which have coloboma without RD, do you do any prophylactic barrage? Because there's a school of thought in which they do barrage, and especially if the fovea is bisected by the coloboma. Maybe the rest of the panel... If there's a coloboma, no RD, do you recommend a prophylactic barrage to the edge of the coloboma to prevent, you know, RD in the future?
No, not at all. If there is no intercalary fluid, we just follow up these cases. If there is fluid in the coloboma, that's one of the points in Dr. Gopal's work also, in one of his papers, that you should only do barrage, foveal sparing barrage, if there is fluid in the intercalary area. Otherwise, why should you do? I wouldn't do it even in an only-eyed patient. And I've got patients for follow-up for 14, 15, 16 years without any issues, who are just coming and for a yearly checkup, and they are doing well without any laser. What for?
Sir, I have a question, one more. Like, once you have drained through the intercalary membrane break or wherever your break was in the colobomatous area, sometimes the intercalary membrane remains so taut, you see that tautness at the edge of the coloboma also. In these cases, do you recommend cutting the membrane? Yeah.
I definitely believe in relaxing it, but very carefully. You have to avoid the blood vessels.
Right. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now,
go ahead. Yeah, fine.
Now we move on to the next topic. I think we'll continue this discussion if we have time later on. Our next topic will be on retinal detachment and high myopia by Dr. Nishikant Bhosle.
Good morning and welcome to this IC. I thank AIS and of course Sangeet for having stitched up a beautiful IC. So my topic is detachment in myopia. It should be high myopia because most of our detachments are in myopics. And we always come across a lot of challenges when it is a high myopia. It starts with high axial length. Many a times you have RK scars. Either the patient has undergone a phakic IOL, which adds to the media problems. We have degenerated multilayered vitreous, the posterior staphyloma, thin atrophic retina, which gives lack of contrast when we operate, a thin sclera, or there are abnormal scleral fibers, and many a times there are associated macular holes. So there are multiple challenges that we face when we are doing a high myopia. Let's try to go through a few of them. Now, many a times when you start off with, there are issues like you have RK scars or phakic IOL. Look at this video, thanks to Dr. Sangeet Mittal. You can see not only there are multiple RK scars and there is an IOL as well. So you need to put a copious amount of viscous fluid on top of it, a viscoelastic, and you need a very good visualization system, because if you don't have a visualization system, there's going to be a lot of media disturbance, and you may not be able to do a judicious job inside, when, especially when you're doing a vitrectomy. So you have to keep in mind that your visualization system has to be good when you are going ahead and doing it in a high myope with RK scars, etc. The second issue that we face is a higher axial length. Now, this is myopic, and we know that there are different patterns of high axial length that we get in myopes. So we need to actually do a B scan before we go ahead to know what sort of scleral pattern we are going to get and what sort of axial length you're going to deal with when you're going to go ahead, and we need to be prepared for it. Well, if you're still not prepared, you can always should be ready to have the increased distance between the two sclerotomies for enabling your instrument reach. Remember that the aura is quite posterior in case of myopes, so you can always have a sclerotomy which is further situated towards posterior side. In case otherwise, you can just go back to our 20 gauge instrumentation, which are having a longer length, or you can even remove the trocars and then increase the reachability. Now, this is one case which I'll show you. The light pipe side, you can of course have a normal 3 mm. Look at this, there is a phakic IOL in this patient. But when you're doing the active instrument, what you can actually do is take it further posterior. But before doing that, be sure by doing a depression and confirm that the aura is slightly posterior. And in that way, we can of course increase the reachability towards the posterior pole when you're doing your vitrectomy. Next is the most challenging, is vitreous. It's degenerated, it's multi-layered, and there is a lot of turbulence if you keep a high flow. So you need to have walled cannulas with a low flow to minimize the turbulence. You have to have a proper staining with triamcinolone. And, oh, I'm so sorry, I just repeated the valve thing again. Now let us look at this. These are cases where, in spite of doing a core vitrectomy and after removing the Wieser's ring, when you stain with triamcinolone, you find this. You will find there are anomalous PVD attachments down, and you have to stain with triamcinolone to go ahead and do a proper peeling of the posterior vitreous from the retina. If you see, there are sometimes layers and layers of retina. This video is thanks to Dr. Umesh Shanmugam. So first, this is the Wieser's ring layer that is getting cut, then is stained with triamcinolone, and then you will find there's another layer that is present. And then to be sure, one can stain on the internal limiting membrane and then go on peeling towards the periphery, and you will still find some amount of vitreous attached there. So this, along with the compounded factor that on the posterior pole we have a low contrast, adds to a lot of problems. So one has to be very patient and take your own time when you're going to do the vitreous dissection. Many a times you have anomalous PVD attachments. You go ahead and stain the posterior pole. The trick is to even try to start off with an ILM peel and extend that ILM peel, and then you can really reach to the anomalous PVD attachments, and only then you can see that, you know, you can reach up to the anomalous PVD attachments, and then we can really make the retina free of all the vitreous. Without that, your surgery is going to be incomplete and you're going to get re-detachments coming in. Now, the posterior staphyloma itself adds to a decreased contrast. Many a times when you do a fluid gas exchange, you will find the fluid is persistent, especially if you have a C-shaped posterior staphyloma behind. Many a times we have a bridging membrane on the posterior staphylomatous pole, which we need to do remove by doing an ILM stealing, peeling. And you have to have a judicious use of PFCL to really settle that retina along with the posterior staphyloma. Now here is a video where when you are removing the triamcinolone, you will find that there is an abnormal membrane that is running across between the macula and here and the disc. And only when this membrane is sort of removed, you will be able to have a proper settlement of the retina in the staphylomatous area. Now, this is extremely difficult to see just like that until and unless you use your stains. So use your stains judicially, use triamcinolone and all your stains judicially in order for you to be able to dissect this properly. When you come to the retina, you will find the retina is thin, it's atrophic. It dances around with your vitrectomy and there is no contrast. So you have to be very careful to locate the holes, to cauterize them. And you always stand a risk of iatrogenic tears. So one has to be very careful. This video, thanks to Dr. Sangeet, is a very beautiful video. You can see there is a tear inferiorly, but as you do a vitrectomy, you can find there's a bit of extension of the tear because the retina always tends to come into your port. There's another tear here. And as you go further, you get suspected tears which are in this area. So look how the retina literally dances every time you are doing a vitrectomy. The retina literally tries to come into the port. So smaller the gauge, the better it is. The low turbulence vitrectomy, the better it is. And yet one has to be very patient and very meticulous when we are doing this start of a surgery. Always, always go ahead and cauterize the holes, because only when you cauterize the holes, then you can actually locate them when you're doing a FG. Otherwise, you tend to lose them. Even if there's a large hole here, you can see there's a mark of the diathermy to mark the beginning and the end of the tear, because the contrast is low and you end up losing the tears, and then you should not get a retinal detachment back. Coming to the thin sclera, again the same pattern, and it actually is very bad when we are doing buckles. So we should have a shallow buckle. If you do there is always a tendency for us to have a very tight buckle because the sclera caves in very easily. And if you're giving a tight buckle, you can have retinal folds, you can have multiple problems in the future. So it's always better to have a shallow a buckle. While buckling, avoid thin areas. You will always come across areas like this when you start your buccal dissection, or initially itself you can chart out thin areas. And remember, there are people who prefer to do scleral tunnels. You can avoid scleral tunnels in such cases because there are high chances of perforation. Take a suture in an area where you're sure the sclera is pretty thick, and only then go ahead and put a buckle. When you are completing everything, you will always find there can be an associated macular hole. Many a times you can get away by dissecting a macular hole in the detachment itself, but a judicious use of PFCL and staining can definitely help one in doing this. Avoid draining through this, because again, you tend to lose it when it goes and settles on the posterior pole, so always better to drain from the periphery and avoid photoreceptor damage itself. Now, when you're completed going towards the tamponade, I would prefer silicone oil if it's a very high myopia. Keep adequate oil, because I know of cases where people have gone with a single bottle of silicone oil to operate at someone else's place, and then they said, oh shucks, the one bottle is not enough, the eye is too large. And keep adequate amount of silicone oil. I really don't know whether there is a value of highway silicone oil. Maybe Dr. Pramod Bhinde will help us to know whether it is good. Use gas only if there are simple retinal detachments with a few holes and you're confident that the gas is just going to help. So high myopic RD surgeries are always a high adrenaline surgery. Be prepared with all your equipment. Be ready with everything. You never know what you're going to need. It should have your extra PFCLs, your extra silicone oil, your chandeliers, and everything possible ready when you're doing that. Be prepared for any complications, and patience and perseverance helps. And then you can convert that high adrenaline into a peaceful surgery if you're really prepared for that from beginning. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Nishikant. I think we have time for a few questions, 1 to 2 questions.
First, I would like Dr. Bhinde to comment upon heavy silicone oil in RDA.
I don't think it's added effect, actually, because Okay. Whether it's heavy or the regular silicone, surface tension is same.
Okay.
Surface tension is same. So there's no obviously added benefit of that.
Okay.
Has anyone in the panel or in the room encountered expulsive hemorrhage in the 20 gauge era in a high myopia while trying to operate a retinal detachment?
Yes.
There, here, even
same
I.
Same here. And so that's a very important risk. But somehow we are not seeing it now with the newer machines. Where is it because we have active pressure control?
Yeah, probably what he has rightly mentioned, wall cannula is more important. Okay. Even if it current era, without wall, there's a sudden jerk fluctuation because that can be another issue. We have cases with that also. But with the wall thing,
it has to be
walled
cannula.
Easier.
I lost a 24-year-old, only eyed patient. And it was a myopic GRT I was operating. And suddenly from all sides, it was devastating actually.
All of us have cases like this.
Yeah, and it's very unfortunate.
So I think it's very important to share these experiences because they are reality and very practical.
My experience was worst. I finished the surgery, I put silicone oil, I finished the sutures, and in the end, when I was looking through the microscope, I saw the whole reflex had become red. And then I realized that there was expulsive, so I had to reopen and try to put it back.
But so these patients, I think, are also predisposed to this hemorrhage. I had one patient in which both eyes had RD. So one eye I operated, she had that subretinal bleed, a massive subretinal bleed. And I took extra precautions while I did the other eye, but again, I had that same problem in the other eye.
Not only they are prone on the table, they are prone on a so-called delayed non-expulsive suprachoroidal hemorrhage. We have second or third day, everything goes well, and next day you open eye, and you have a massive hemorrhage inside that. That's a non-expulsive variant of suprachoroidal hemorrhage. We have those cases also experienced.
So anybody has any experience on macular buckles in these types of cases?
Yeah, I do macular buckle as well. And I have hemorrhage following macular buckle, also one of our cases. Okay. So, no, my macular chiasis specifically, I'm very particular about peeling of ILM. These cases, it can be extremely difficult sometimes. Pardon? Yeah, because layers. And you, so till you get a staining of ILM, then you know. Only that there is no vitreous there. Because I have 3 or 4 or 5 layers even there. And particularly second or third case when I was doing, we assume with a tricot everything come out. And when you inject, and you see again, there is no staining. And then when I use, that was the point I wanted to tell you, like, use high mag. Yes, wide angle system we all are used to. We are very comfortable. But these are the eyes when you work on a macula. Look with a high magnification, contact lens system is based in this scenario, and then I could see another something shimmering reflex comes out, another shimmering reflex. So if your like a BBG, if it's not staining, that means something, there is a barrier between ILM and you. That's the take it for granted. Go back, put some more tricot, and you'll see somewhere some another layer comes up, lump, another cleans up. That's Dr. Madhu from like a Shankar Eye. He is one of the videos he shows in one of the RetNet meeting, if you remember, 5 layers of vitreous he has removed. Okay.
Yeah, so there is sometimes it just doesn't get over.
Yeah.
I mean, you feel where the hell the vitreous is coming in from. You know, you go on cutting it and it keeps coming in.
I think
it's like that.
I think with the future, we have this microscopic integrated OCT nowadays. We have experience for 6 months. So it's beautifully seen in the microscopic integrated OCT. The future is good actually. Once we have this integrated OCTs,
also
I think there will be more sure of the membranes. And
absolutely.
The
one more caution here is because quite a few people, they want to use this brilliant blue is in the with the fluid field cavity. What he has shown is did fluid erection and then added. Probably these are the eyes, I said avoid those things. Because what happened during this process and turbulence, though we say all settled down, but sometime it has a turbulence because second time, third time when we need to do multiple layers, it stains posterior capsule also. And if you stain posterior capsule, already compromised scenario, you don't have contrast and all this scenario, then you are in trouble. Whether it's phakic eyes or pseudophakic eyes, if intact posterior capsule is there, it stains, it's a hail for you.
You're better to do a bit of amount of FG, at least you should have some air in the front.
And before putting a fluid again, I mean not directly fluid and then simultaneously remove, I ensure that entire BBG is removed before you start the fluid.
And one good point you made was the use of Landers ring in this case, is because many a times you have difficulty in manipulating your instruments.
So Landers ring? Or if you're using a non-contact.
Yeah,
no. Yeah, no problem.
So we move on to our next talk, which is retinal detachment and giant retinal tears by Dr. Saurabh Muluth.
I thank Dr. Sangeet for this opportunity. So I won't go into the details, I mean the theoretical details. Skeepens first described three types of giant retinal tear. The pathogenesis is liquefaction of the central gel and formation of a cavity with relentlessly progressive shrinkage of the remaining gel. It can also result following trauma, or in large areas of chorioretinal scarring, especially in eyes with acute retinal necrosis, can give rise to GRT, and can also be seen on the posterior aspect of white without pressure area in myopic eyes. It can also be a part of syndromes like Stickler's, Marfan's, Ehlers-Danlos. Also seen after attempted removal of intravitreal nuclear fragments post cataract surgery complications, or also as a complication of pars plana vitrectomy. It has to be differentiated from retinal dialysis, in which in the retinal dialysis there is retinal disinsertion, and vitreous bridges the dialysis gap, whereas in a GRT, there is a posterior flap and an anterior flap, and vitreous remains strongly attached to the anterior margin of the tear. There is a classification which can be based on extent or on the severity of PVR. Pre-op evaluation is important to see the size and the precise location, mobility of the posterior flap, radial extension, amount of vitreous liquefaction, abnormal areas of vitreous condensation, and extent of PVR. Several techniques have been used in the historical past for GRT, some of them with, you know, face down positioning on the table and with retinal tacks, etc., but I won't go into that. But nowadays we are used to doing pars plana vitrectomy and using PFCL, which was introduced by Chang. So PFCL is a heavy fluid and it has a specific gravity of 1.9 with low viscosity, and we all know how PFCL is used. I'll just show you this in the, as part of my video, so I'll just skip these slides. And it provides a third hand, you know, while doing the surgery. Role of scleral buckle is a little controversial, but even if there is early PVR, you can manage without a scleral buckle, but definitely in these cases, you know, putting a scleral buckle can, you know, make fish mouthing of the GRT and, you know, create problems. So only in advanced cases of PVR do you need a scleral buckle to support the vitreous space. So I'll just go to my videos because this is just a description of the steps. And lens management, primary surgical goal is to reattach. So in cases with advanced PVR, you know, sometimes it's a good idea to remove the lens also. So retinectomy, anterior flap of the torn retina, the configuration of the posterior edge of the tear, and if there's a rolled unstable posterior edge, all these determine how you do the retinectomy, but the anterior flap should be completely removed to prevent recurrences. Endolaser is very important, and you can either do a PFCL air exchange or a direct PFCL silicon oil exchange, which most of us are used to doing. So I'll just go to the video because we are short of time. So this is a 23-gauge vitrectomy for a GRT without PVR. Can you please play this video? Yeah, it's not playing. Can you play it from the file directly, please? So you can see that we are starting the vitrectomy here, and as Dr. Sangeet was saying, that you know, the retina moving towards the port just shows that there is no PVD, so staining with the IVTA, and it's very difficult, it's a young patient, very difficult to initiate the PVD with forceps, as Dr. Shobhit said, has to be used sometimes to initiate the PVD. And the retina is very mobile, you can see that. And we can take the PVD to as far as in the periphery as possible, but very importantly, it has to be removed from the edge of the GRT, and also the horns have to be freed of all the vitreous. That is very important. Complete the vitrectomy. And now we have switched on to the bimanual mode with the chandelier, and this helps because you can depress and, you know, excise the vitreous from the horns, and from also, you know, completely remove the anterior flap. Then using LPFC all the way, you can fill up the whole vitreous cavity till it goes beyond the edge of the giant retinal tear, which is flattened. And then we start the laser to the edge of the giant retinal tear. Again, depression helps in this bimanual vitrectomy because you can do laser on the horns and also completely laser the area with good visualization. And then directly doing a PFCL silicon oil exchange. In this, a very important step is to keep draining the fluid between, which is sandwiched between the oil and the LPFC, because this will prevent slippage of the giant retinal tear. And then complete removal of PFCL is also very important. So this is the end of the case with the removal of the chandelier. And this is the post-op picture of the giant retinal tear case. Can I have my next video? So this is another case of giant retinal tear in a child. And in this, we are doing a 25 gauge vitrectomy. This has PVR, and you know there are rolled edges, so those have to be freed, and also membranes are being peeled. It's important that the rolled edges of the GRT are, you know, kind of straightened, and they have to be sometimes excised after diathermy, so that, you know, once you put the PFCL, it flattens and it is not raised, because again that will cause slippage. So it is very important to unroll the edges and sometimes, you know, freshen them up, excise with the cutter after doing diathermy. So again, bimanual vitrectomy is, you know, very important in this case. It is very helpful. And then just flatten out with the PFCL. So in this case, I did not use any encerclage band, and I got away because the PVR was limited. And always have your tip within the PFCL bubble while injecting to avoid, you know, frog eggs. And then doing a direct PFCL silicon oil exchange. And again, making sure that you are removing the fluid, and which is at anterior to the PFCL edge, because that is the one which causes slippage of the giant retinal tear when you are exchanging it with the silicon oil. So this is the post-op picture of this pediatric GRT. So just a word about, you know, the fellow eye, which is important because these are the eyes which, you know, are prone to giant retinal tear and are considerable risk. Incidence as much as 59.8%, and average latent period was seen to be about 3.5 years. And they should be followed up regularly. And Freeman has a paper in which, you know, he says that several high risk characteristics he noted, like high myopia, more than 10 diopters, increasing white with pressure, and increasing condensation of the vitreous base. And some of them have even recommended, even Freeman in his paper has recommended a prophylactic scleral buckle in these high-risk cases of the fellow eyes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. A few points I'd like to make, sir, and have the opinion of the house also, is the amount of laser in these patients, a heavy laser or a light laser? I think light laser is preferable in these patients.
Yeah, obviously, because the more laser you do, again, a problem, inflammation is more. So light laser, you are out, there is a controversy, somebody says 2 rows, 3 rows, somewhere between, somebody say 5 to 7 rows, as long as you cover all around. What I do generally is, the first row along the edge of TRT is contiguous. And then maybe I generally prefer somewhere around 5 rows, and second, third, fourth, fifth, generally a gap of 1 bond width, and then go around. So that minimizes, and in between the laser one, the time is there, that retina, when a contracting retina to stretch and compensate for that. But first line, I put contiguous.
And there is no role of buckle or encircling band in these cases at all. That will only cause more folds and
if
issues.
If what I meant was if there is PVR, advanced
PVR. If
there
PVR. Is PVR also, then also?
No, that's, see, if you have up to 90 degrees, 100 degrees, 110 degrees, is fine. The role of buckle here is to support the horns, not tear,
yes.
As against what we do in other
exactly.
RD cases. But if you have more than 180 degree, your already traction is relieved. There's no, whether it's even PVR is there, because it's already detached, every like separated from that more than 180 degree, it just there's no role.
I would rather enlarge the GRT on both sides by a retinectomy to make it more and relieve the traction at the horns rather than put a buckle.
If that I do something, if it is more than 270 degree, I make it 360 degree.
Yeah.
But around 180, 100, around 200, I won't do that.
Supposingly it is 90 degree tear and a phakic patient, you are doing lens sparing vitrectomy and GRT, I think then would it be a good idea to put a buckle in to support the other areas?
I do that. I do that. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
to
so in limited cases,
less than 180 degree
use.
Probably
yeah.
Try
probably
to support. Yeah, I think that's that you wanted to check. Yeah, that's one. Anterior flap almost always excised. Because that is the one which will roll up. That is the one which is caused PVR. And when there's contraction subsequently, can lead to hypotony. Not only that, once this contracts, the other area edge where the ends, with that past spina can remain detached there and fluid seep through, and later on, you can come back with recurrence. So, definitely up to the aura, and if past plana is detached, invariably detached in these eyes, whatever is free, I remove it off.
So one more thing in this patients, like what are your comments on the direct PFCL oil or PFCL with air and then oil?
I think that is the individual perception and how they are trained. Just one extra step, but I think we all are trained, being Shankar Netalai, do direct PFCL silicon, but a lot of people, they do go with fluid exchange, fluid PF selection, and then inject oil. I think it's either way is okay. But issue is that invariably what happened, we all know, when you do fluid erection, the repeated fluid accumulation.
Mm.
And when that happens, there is a more likelihood of flap slippage in eyes with where you do fluid PF selection and then go back to silicon. There's relative incidence is more. That you want to do under a PFCL. You want to finish that under PFCL, all manipulation. Because with the air, what happened, because of reflexes, your visibility is significantly compromised. And you don't want to dig into choroid at that time.
And secondly, the edge will get engaged.
Yeah.
Under air, there is higher.
The retina can get engaged, yes.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Rather than the cutting, I think it's better to make that decision.
Yeah.
Yeah,
wherever
you
can
answer.
Yeah,
we
do that.
We move on to our next talk
you.
By Dr. Pramod Bhinde. He'll be speaking on retinal detachment in pediatric age group.
Yeah, so thanks to Sangeet and also AIOS Managing Committee for accepting this course and for having me here. So basically, directly, let me start here. Like incidence of retinal detachment in children somewhere around 1.57 to 5.9. I'm restricting here exclusively for Agbutinus RD, not discussing other areas. So basically, a unique epidemiological feature has anatomical characteristics. That's why this is a special entity. Macular detachment is more common. There is high incidence of PVR. And there's need for multiple surgery in these eyes. Diagnosis is generally delayed because of generally it's a slow progress RD because of generally vitreous gel, less acute loss of vision, and so patients fare well to report the symptoms. Most of the time, either it is diagnosed when you come for a regular eye examination or when a problem in other eye, and then you go for examination and realize there is RD in a second eye as well. So misdiagnosis is not uncommon, and almost 9% incidence of they diagnose as a squint and they go for examination, realize there is underlying detachment. And hence, because of the delayed diagnosis, because of other issues, and chronic detachment. Generally, prognosis is poor, and also there's high incidence of amblyopia even after repair. Also, these patients generally they have associated lot of congenital anomalies. So higher detachment at a younger age, and also higher incidence of having other eye involvement because of same reasons. So patient may report when, as I said, when second eye macula is involved. Again, trauma is one of the more commonest cause, and outdoor trauma, so boys are more commonly involved than the girls. So of course scenario is changing now. So inability to determine the preoperative vision, that's a practical difficulties what we have when you examine these eyes. Difficult and time-consuming pre- and post-operative evaluation. As we know, patients are not cooperative. And invariably, you need to do evaluation under anesthesia to assess or extend the damage and when you want to plan the treatment. So as you see here, trauma is the commonest thing, as I said, around 27 to 56%, followed by high myopia and previous ophthalmic surgery, particularly congenital cataract, lensectomy done, or cataract surgery done. Now we are doing at 6 months, 2 months, 1 year, and they are implanting IOL. That's one of the commonest cause leading almost up to 51% eyes. The incidence is increasing with that. Other congenital common disorders, ROP is not a common congenital disorder, but it's a common childhood problem. Incidence is somewhere about 7.5 to 14%. We'll come to that a little bit later. Then FEVR. Retinoschisis, choroidal coloboma, which we discussed, almost 40 to 42% incidence of RD, those are having a choroidal coloboma. And again, Stickler's, juvenile glaucoma, and other things. The presenting symptom is decreased vision is almost in 62 to 93% of these eyes, followed by squint and leukocoria. And symptoms is variable. As we, our study is somewhere right from 1 day to almost 7 years, RD is there. And round atrophic hole is the most commonest than the horseshoe tear in these eyes. So typically what you see here, how to manage these eyes, if you have clear media, you have localized detachment, you have multiple or single row of lattices, and with atrophic breaks, these eyes generally work out very well with a scleral buckling. That is my first choice in the eyes, and almost success rate is somewhere around 90 to 100%. So technique of surgery is more or less similar what we do in adult. Obviously, everything is to be done under general anesthesia, cryopixie. Generally, I use a combination. If you have a lattices or lesions in attached retina, I use laser at the same time. And then detached retina, I use cryo, basically minimize the inflammation. And depending on the lesion location, you use a segmental buckle, support with add-on with an encircling band, which is generally preferred. And if detachment is old, subretinal fluid drainage is preferred. So problem areas we have here, generally these kids, they have sclera is thin, muscles are thin, and it's not uncommon while tagging the muscle, you may snap the muscle as well. While trying to pass suture, scleral perforation is very, very common in eyes. When you put the buckle, again, orbit is small, so placing this buckle within the orbit sometime can cause a problem. After you finish surgery, and putting eye back in the orbit sometime can be extremely difficult. And again, induce myopia and high risk of amblyopia in the this is the age particularly for that. So coming to vitrectomy per se, indication would be, already we saw the video now, giant retinal tear, very large breaks, undetected, or posterior breaks, or multiple breaks in different locations, old detachment with extensive subretinal field, contracted retina, severe PAR, post-buccal recurrent detachment, and RD associated with congenital or developmental disorders. So probably these are the indications. So anatomical consideration when you deal with these eyes, axial length is smaller, approximately 70% of that of eye, and again it varies with the age. Smaller cornea you have, and when you look at these eyes, you have anterior segment is 80% developed by age of 1 to 2 years, but posterior segment is only 20% compared to the adults. And scleral thickness is at 6 months of age is 0.4, so practically when you look at it, when you're using this trocar cannula system and stape incision, it doesn't make sense any, though you think psychologically that I have made a stape incision, it's 0.4 millimeter thickness of sclera, practically it's a unipolar incision most of the time. And reduced scleral rigidity, we'll come to that little bit, I'll show you what happened with that. So lens, unfortunately, is almost as large as adult size here. So chances of lens touch are very, very high, so you have to be extremely careful while doing vitrectomy, particularly if you want to save the lens. Pars placata is as almost 2 millimeter, but pars plana again is very, very narrow. So generally your sclerotomies are through pars placata. And sometimes you can use a transillumination to look at the location before making your sclerotomies. But vitreous is extremely sticky and there is no PVD in most of these eyes. So as I said, like again, basic principles are same, three-port vitrectomy, anterior place sclerotomy, we'll come little to that. Wide angle visualization system is extremely helpful in the eyes. The practical issue is lens is contact or non-contact lens is larger, cornea is smaller, and particularly when you want a sclerotomy more or less straight down towards the optic nerve, parallel to visual axis, you keep on bumping against the visualization system, those lens, and then you can losing your views. So you have to find a way between, and you get now smaller diameter lenses, contact lenses, as well as I think the biome has a little bit smaller diameter. Obviously, it cuts down your field to some extent, but it's still worth having it. So these are just grass guidelines, somewhere you can make, somewhere if it less than, I mean, kids, when ROP surgery, I do somewhere 0.5 to 0.75 millimeter from the limbus, and according to age, you go either 1.5, 2, 2.5, and anything beyond 3 years, more or less, normal location sclerotomies you can do is. And this is what I wanted to show. Look at it. This, though even they are new instrument, look at how the sclera is getting distorted because of low scleral rigidity here. And it's, you are always worried about pushing and hitting somewhere inside. Look at the things the way. And this is, that's why always when you are doing pediatric age, use new set, avoid older one. Reusing should be avoided. Otherwise, you'll end up in a lot of trouble. And this is high risk of, again, leaking sclerotomy at the end of the surgery. So almost always we need to suture these sclerotomies when you complete a surgery in a pediatric age group, just like pediatric cataract surgery is what you do. PVD induction, as I said, firm vitreous, sticky vitreous, extremely difficult. This is a schisis. This is another case. See, like the way literally holding, pulling with the forceps, suction did not work. Here somehow I managed, but what you see here, okay, whole retina getting pulled here, and particularly if retina is mobile, there's no counteraction, things become even much more difficult. You look at this, literally holding with the forceps, whole thing just lifts up, you leave it, it goes back. It takes up sometime even 1.5 hours to cover those areas. And then this is another case, I use a tricot to stain this vitreous to peel this off, but still again using forceps, and this case took almost 45 minutes just to induce the PVD. Subsequent stage where, I mean, other issue, but things become easier. But unless you induce PVD, you are going to fail the surgery. Well, silicone oil is more commonly used, particularly again compliance of patients, maintaining prone position, other issues are there. So, but whatever problem is, emulsification also is much earlier in these eyes. In general, however, these eyes generally have even poor anatomical prognosis with single surgery, but overall when you combine the surgery, like multiple surgeries, final outcome is reasonably as good as somewhere around 90%, nowadays 80 to 90%. I am not going to go in a specific entities because we don't have time, we can always discuss if time permits. So basically, coloboma we already discussed, it's not going to. So basically, unlike adult RDs, periodic detachments have distinct etiology, presentation, and characteristics. Though basic surgical principles are same, these eyes have their unique challenges. Age and disease-based planning, including selection of proper gauge of the instruments, is needed for better pre, intra, and post-operative management, and multiple surgeries or resurgeries are not uncommon. To reduce detachment incidence and improve anatomical and visual outcome, early diagnosis and prompt management is the key in these eyes. Exam for the other eye under general anesthesia is very, very important. As I said, there's a very high incidence having problem, at least even if no detachment. See, most of these eyes have some precursors of detachment in other eye. We need to improve techniques, particularly for cataract surgery, as I mentioned, in children, and to have good amblyopia management. And there's a need to continuous follow up throughout their life because they are again prone to have a glaucoma as well. And for that, counseling of parents is very, very important. One time surgery and everything is done, you cannot take it for granted. Parents have to be counseled and motivated to have lifelong checkup. Thank you very much for patient here.
Thank you, sir. In the meantime, the laptops get exchanged. We can have a little bit of discussion if there are any questions. Any questions?
Sir, what percentage of patients you'd belt buckle or scleral buckling along with the vitrectomy in pediatric retinal detachment cases? Any like more preference to adult patients in such?
Yeah, probably because I said vitreous is sticky, vitreous is firm, and you cannot detach the vitreous completely in these eyes. So if I am not doing RR 360 degree, almost 100%.
So sometimes you some.
Yeah, encircling band. Yeah.
Somewhere you mentioned using the shorter cannulas in these patients.
Yeah, that's because of time lag I didn't show. We get now shorter, smaller instruments. Shorter instruments are available both with Alcon, with Dark, and other companies are coming up. So that's one way using those because it's an 18 millimeter cutter. And light pipe also and laser also is smaller one. So those are useful. They get 25 gauge also. We have those instruments. So particularly these eyes. But even trocar cannula system also is smaller. So that particularly what happened ROP cases when you're doing 4 millimeter of trocar and you have 9.5 to 10 millimeter of blade which has to go inside. So many times the elevated retina, straight PS retina there. We have a couple of cases like that. So that's why we started using shorter instrument. The issue is there. Because it's 2.5 millimeter cannula, old days we used to use, that cannula, particularly when you put infusion, it has to be sutured to the sclera. It does, it's not a self-retaining. That you have to be keep in mind. Okay.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Pointer
we move on to Dr. Ramandeep Singh, who will be speaking on managing post-traumatic retinal detachments.
Good morning. So I'll be talking about the post-traumatic retinal detachment. The traumatic RD can happen in an open globe injury and closed globe injury, you know. And open globe injuries, little, you know, RDs are, you know, not like other RDs because now you have a choroid and your iris and the cornea is getting involved. So you have lots of other things like media opacities are there, the vitreous hemorrhage will be there, the choroidal detachment, serous or hemorrhagic will be there. So they are different RDs. So it happens nearly in 30% of the patient. If you have a foreign body, nearly up to 40%. So it's basically a penetrating or a perforating trauma. The intervention is by and large a PPV with or without buckle. So you can do buckle in less than 1% of the patient where you have a specifically a superior zone 2, zone 3 tear and a break there. And normally they are associated with a poor prognosis. So there are prognostic issues in these patients because if you go by ocular trauma score, there are, you can definitely tell the patient if you have initial poor visual acuity, RAPD, and all those things, you can talk to the patient that I may do a good job, maybe anatomically I'll be able to attach, but functionally I don't know. If there is a corneal involvement and the zone involvement, very important, the posterior is the zone, you know, and more is the, trouble with the surgery and more poor with the outcome. The issues with the VR surgeon are what we have to, there are some things which you have to decide. The timings of surgery, I'll be detailing about it later. Cataract, of course, you can manage if you have, you can manage with a phaco IOL depending on your competence or your anterior segment competence, what you can do and put an IOL in that surgery or if the PC is intact. The buckle, I think lots of people put buckle in all of these patients. My is if you have a inferior, involvement in the zones, so I always put a 240 there. Superiorly, I don't do it in these patients, but I tend to put buckle in these patients because these are the eyes who are massive tears, so more amount of chances of PVR in these patients. Tamponade, by and large, it's the oil in these patients. So this is what I meant about when I talk about the timings of the surgery. There are always been taught for last 20, 30 years, two schools of thoughts. They talk about early vitrectomy and the delayed vitrectomy. Both have their own, sense of this thing. Delayed vitrectomy talks about, if you have a choroidal detachment, the choroids becomes the hemorrhage becomes, more of a liquefied so that you can drain it and there are less chances of re-bleed. So you wait for 10, 14 days and then do it. And of course, sometimes the PVD occurs and the risk of excess is bleeding is less. On the other hand, the other people think that if you keep hypotony of the eye after you repaired the tear there, it might cause corneal issues there. You might not be able to take up these patients later on. Of course, a tear is there, more chances of epiretinal membrane, more chances of traumatic PVR, which is much more devastating than the PVR. So these are the two schools of thoughts which are going on. But by and large, the popular thought is because our Indian eyes have lots of these choroidal injuries, we see lots of these hemorrhagic choroidals. In the Western population, most of the studies, they don't have choroidal hemorrhagic choroidal detachment. So they are doing early vitrectomy also. And the first time there's in retina, there's a randomized controlled trial they have done, which was lacking in the literature. So they did it, but they found that the 4-5 surgery at the 4 days is much better than. But if you go to the paper and read it, you will find that only 4 of their eyes in their 21 and 25 had zone 3 injury. So they didn't have hemorrhagic choroidals in their patients. So I don't think this study is still going to be relevant. To what I propagate, I do is do a B scan at 10 days. If the choroidals are liquefied and the RD is present, I go ahead and do surgery in these patients. This is one such patient who had a one-eyed patient, and in that eye also he had a trauma there, and he was no PL because of one-eyed status and vitreous hemorrhage. We did a VEP, but still could tell him that let's do a surgery in his eyes, because we know that in a dense hemorrhagic eyes, sometimes you never know what is going to happen. So we took up this patient for the surgery. And these are just a few steps I'll be showing, that these surgeries are not simple surgeries. They are long surgeries, preferably done under GA, because you know that you may take 3-4 hours there. As I've already said, I did put the buckle there, and this is what I call it the cave spelunking. You know, you have to spend hours and hours looking for the retina there in the vitreous cavity because the hemorrhage is there. So my key is always go towards the nasal side, because because a good ultrasound will tell you where is the RD, and preferably you do the ultrasound yourself. That is very important, because you are the surgeon, the onus is on you, and you find out where I am going to start this. I'm going to start separating the blood from this thing. So see, I found a plane there. If you find a plane without causing a iatrogenic break, and I think the battle is won in this patient. So this is what we did in this patient. We could manage to hand motions day one and counter finger 2 meters, and this patient is now 660 after the oil removal. You can see his VEP also got a flat, and now we can see a wave there. So one of the rare 26 patients of no PL operated and did a good outcome in these patients. And another entity I said is closed globe injury. You know, closed globe injury is, RD is more common in these, because these are the eyes that young patients will come with trauma. You never know, but they don't have any predisposing features. Still, they have RD. We know that the trauma they are behind. So it's 50 to 60% as high as in various series. So if you rule out predisposing risk factors in RD in young is by and large, it's a traumatic kind of a thing. Counter cuckoo is I don't have to go into details of this. Intervention can be buckle alone, and they are associated with a good prognosis. So here I divide these eyes into two arms, where you can have two things there happening. These eyes are mostly they have RD without PVD. You know, this is one group. So this occurs early or late after the trauma. You have this Berlin's edema in the periphery, and the atrophic retina gets away, and they will have a detachment there, a dialysis there. So they will not have a PVD there. Once these eyes, as Dr. Pramod has already said, you have a PVD there, no PVD there, young patient. If you have no posterior breaks, you can go ahead with a buckle in these patients, and they do really well in these patients. PPV is required only if you have media opacities there, if you have a vitreous hemorrhage there, if you have a posterior break there. So the PPV may be required in the other patient. So there's another group which will now, because the vitreous has also borne the insult of the trauma, so they will have vitreous changes. Now the PVD will occur while the PVD has occurred in the young patient, so it will cause tears there in the periphery, and it will occur late. There will be history of trauma. So it will be like a normal RD, depending on your competence. Fakic eye, you can plan a buckle, or you can or a PPV, depending on the PVR in these patients. This is one such. I wrote there this is a GRT without PVD is very rare, but it can happen in these patients. This is one such patient of trauma, and operated by my colleague in PGI, Dr. Deeksha. And this patient has a posterior GRT there, and you will see when he had a macula on RD even. When we stay in it, there was no PVD, so we could this can happen in trauma, and it's very important to know that. So the carry-home message is, RD with open globe injury is a challenging scenario. I said meticulous planning, starting from the repair You should know the zone of repair. You should always tell the primary surgeon to write the zone. You should do the ultrasound yourself. You should, so that you can do the proper PPP in these patients. Poor initial vision and the posterior extent, most extent, is the prognostic markers. RD with closed globe injury have, in my hand, it's a, I think it's a better prognosis eyes. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Raman. So in the meantime, the laptops are being exchanged. We can have a few questions. So Raman, if there is a double perforation, what is your approach? Sometimes you can see.
I mean, double perforation, because we see these, lots of these, the palate injuries are coming to us. I mean, the approach remains that we have to do a, definitely a PPV after the primary repair has been done, because by and large, these will have a posterior perforation will be there. So if you delay them, the RD will occur. Even if the RD is not there in the patient, these patients have to be operated early. So earlier is the management. It's better than these patients.
So I,
No, sir. The time of surgery is depends on the hemorrhagic. If the choroidals are there, if the hemorrhagic choroidals are there, then we have to wait. Okay. If the hemorrhagic choroidals are not there and media is clear enough, and you go ahead with the surgery at day 4-5.
Yeah,
because eventually the RD will occur in this patient. Dr. Pramod.
Inwardly posterior perforation, you want to wait for some time, maybe not long, wait, like maybe 4 or 5 days are enough. What happened to the posterior perforation and surrounding fibrosis helps subsequent closer it, and maybe leaking that posterior perforation burning while doing vitrectomy can be minimized. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, anterior posterior perforation, you have vitreous incursion, sometimes it fibrose, contracts, and proliferates so quickly, it can be a thick band, and sometimes removal become extremely, extremely difficult. So you want to go ahead earlier in these eyes. But again, you want to leave that plug in the vitreous, which is there posterior, suppose is there in a posterior perforation. That small plug, you want to leave it like that. If you try to shave it up and sometime you open that up, sometime it's so posterior, extremely difficult to seal that one, extremely difficult to suture it. There are other issues. They tried different one, method or methods and all those things sometime, but it's not only that, there are incidences, reports that PFCL going through that, silicon oil going through that in orbit. There are other like reports as well. So we definitely want to wait for at least those 4 or 5 days for before taking them. Unless you are waiting for 2 days, that's a different indication.
Yeah.
Sir, we did few cases with where there was a posterior perforation and it was a leaking site from the posterior. We put in gel foam and it worked very well.
Yeah, that's what, like gel foam is one option.
We did 4 cases, we put in a posterior perforation, put in gel foam and it worked well and the globe was maintained, tension was maintained.
Great.
I think I saw Dr. Tarek sitting there, so that's why I asked this question. if Neeraj, if you are ready. Yeah. So we move on to our next, and this is the last topic, retinal detachment with proliferative vitreoretinopathy. Dr. Neeraj Chanduja.
Is it coming full? I think some problem here. Excuse me.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sangeet, for giving me this opportunity. My topic is on retinal detachment with PVR. The incidence of retinal detachment with PVR is 7 to 8% following primary retinal detachment surgery. But in case you have retinal detachment, then the chances of PVR increases. And the strategies to manage PVR, it is very important to understand what are the cases where we see more cases who develop retinal detachment with PVR. These are cases with the chronic retinal detachment, having large retinal breaks, giant retinal tear, post-trauma, or any previous intraocular surgery, having associated vitreous hemorrhage, or younger patients. The goals of management is to attach the retina and to relieve all traction, epiretinal, subretinal, and to see the any foreshortening of the retina and to relax it also. The key steps are, as we have already discussed, like first the posterior hyoid face has to be removed and then remove all the membranes. And it is very important in to see the cases who develop a recent PVR, the membranes are very fragile and they don't come in toto. So I'll be showing some videos of retinal detachment, cases who had previous retinal detachment surgeries. Video is not coming. Hello?
ले लें वीडियो?
नहीं नहीं मैं कर रहा हूँ सर, आपका लैपटॉप ऑफ करो, प्रेजेंटेशन भी रख लें।
Maybe I'll play from the So this was a case of retinal detachment having fragile membranes. You can see with the this steno brush, we are just scraping the thin membranes which are overlying the retina. And it is very difficult to pinpoint where the membranes are. Either you have to use a tricot or triple blue membrane to stain these membranes. And you just have to give fine strokes with the membrane scraper over the retina to peel off these membranes, because they are, don't come in toto. You just have to see where the membranes are. You can see here, we are just peeling off and the retina is lifting up, showing that membranes are there. And here is the site of previous retinotomy there, and the membranes are quite thick over here. We are just trying to find the gap between the membranes with the help of a tenno scraper and to dissect the membranes and to take out the folds from the retina. And you need to be very gentle in this maneuver, otherwise the retina can tear off also. And once these membranes have been separated and identified, you need to go with the end gripping forceps. You can see, you can catch hold of the edge of the membranes, very fine membranes, and they don't come in toto, they come bit by bit. So you need to take identify these membranes and take them out gently without damaging the retina. And we are just trying to catch hold of all the membranes which we had identified with the help of tenno scraper and trying to peel it off. This takes a lot of time, a lot of patience, but you need to take out these membranes, otherwise in your post-operative period, these membranes will again mature and will lead to retinal detachment. So once these membranes have been identified, you can see we are able to peel off these membranes nicely with the end gripping forceps. And this retina was quite shortened, so we had to do, because earlier this case was operated twice, so we did cautery 360 degree, and now removing the doing the retinotomy, extending it with the help of vitrectomy cutter. And your suction of the cutter has to be low at this point of time. And once you have seen taken out the epiretinal membrane, done the retinotomy, you need to identify whether any subretinal membranes are there or not. Because any subretinal membrane, if left behind, will lead to more chances of retinal detachment in post-operative period. And you can see these fine membranes are there, subretinal also. We are trying to peel it off, whatever we can take it off, to relax the retina and make it mobile. And the PFCL has been injected over the posterior pole to keep the posterior retina flat so that the counter-traction is there from the remaining retina. And you can see these membranes are being lifted and peeled off gently from the surface, underneath surface of the retina. And once all these membranes are peeled off, then still I'm struggling with the membrane, you can see. And this was a site of previous retinotomy, so membranes are more adherent, and PFCL silicone exchange is done, and you can see the retina is nicely attached. Yeah, next PA, yeah. So this is another case, already undergone two vitreous surgeries, the silicone oil silicone removal was done, and you can see large breaks, two breaks were there, inferotemporal and supranasal breaks, supratemporal breaks, and the retina, still some membranes are sticking to the edges of the breaks, and we're just trying to peel it off. You can see the remaining posterior hyaluronic face, which is at the edge of the vitreous base, is still there and pulling the retina. It is very important to take out all the remaining vitreous and do base excision also to see where the vitreous is left behind. And you have to trim all edges of the breaks which are rolled out, otherwise the retina is not likely to settle. And transluminal was injected to see whether any remaining breaks or any remaining vitreous was there or not. Now the cauterization was done and break edges were trimmed out. And we did fluid air exchange in this patient after doing the retinotomy, but the and the band was also tightened with the intention of giving more indentation because air was going subretinal.
after fluid exchange, but even then the retina was not settling down. So we had to again increase the relaxing retinotomy. We were a little cautious because doing retinotomy 360 degree then again increases the chances of retinal detachment with more PVR. But still, after this putting PFCL and putting air, the retina was not settling down. The air was going subretinal. So we had to do, you can see the retina is still not settling down with the by putting air also. Still traction was left behind. So the aim was to do a 360 degree retinotomy to settle the retina. And after doing PFCL siliconal exchange, now the retina is attached and it is being followed by doing laser to the edges of the retinotomy and followed by PFCL siliconal exchange. Yeah.
Just a small request, can you just...
Yeah, so these are the preoperative and postoperative photographs of these patients. The retina is nicely settled. And so the complications of PVR repair is you have more chances of opting of insult, and the patient can land up into hypotony also. So today we are able to repair most eyes with RD with PVR with great confidence and good surgical outcome. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. I thank my co-instructors and for this wonderful session. And I request the audience to fill in the feedback form as requested by the AIOS. I also thank Raman for allowing us to few extra minutes on this meeting.
Then is that I also had in two cases subretinal air. I don't know where doing fluid air exchange, where it came. And I had to do a relaxer retinotomy then to get it out. I tried my manures or PFCL and other things, but is there any other method to prevent it to going from subretinal?
See, if you're having a subretinal air going, either the membranes are left behind, yeah, subretinal or epiretinal.
There was nothing. Retina was settled. I was doing laser and all of a sudden one bubble went and it created havoc.
It means
right now it was going right, left, some way, then I had to do a peripheral retinotomy and get it out. And it doesn't give a good vision prognosis because then you have to do a lot of laser and chances of more PVR in future are there.
So it is shortening of the retina?
Yeah, basically it's a shortening of the retina.
Yeah.
Though we remove the membrane as much as possible, but there is intrinsic contraction. Now, when you do fluid air exchange, air has surface tension. It's significantly high compared to oil and PFCL. And when you do gradual one, probably it stretches the retina, will attach. But little bit disturbance here, there, or your globe get pressed somewhere else, other thing, and that little bit disturbance good enough to, because it's still it is not fully stretched retina or not fully mobile retina, it just peeps into it. Very commonly what you see, this one is nicely reattached retina with the air. You do a laser, you put the oil and close, and next day you see silicone oil is subretinal. Because again, because of difference in the surface tension, that's very commonly it happens.
Sir, one more help is that while doing 27 gauge vitrectomy, there is a lot of problem in inducing the PVD, especially once the vitreous hemorrhage is quite dense. Is it with me or it's
that
there?
Is that is because, see, again, a
27
trans-RFL surface that force you generate.
Yeah.
So when you use 25 and then now we are going to 27,
yeah,
you need almost somewhere at 500 to 600, you have to use that suction.
Yeah.
Then only you'll be able to, because you need to grasp a big chunk, particularly when you have a pediatric agent, you are trying to just pull it off, vitreous is firmly other. And
yeah.
Like with 20 gauge, you used to use somewhere 100 and 150. Now you went to 200, 250, 300. If 27 you want, you need almost somewhere around 600 so suction to really have its effect. Because port is small, so the suction...
And especially if the vitreous hemorrhage is dense or membrane is dense, it doesn't...
Yeah.
Okay, sir, thank you.